I'm Bill Covino, the president here at Cal State LA. Welcome. Thank you. Thank you all for being here today. Many thanks to our partners, the Women's Heart Alliance and the Clinton Foundation. We're really truly honored that you've chosen Cal State LA to host this important event. The goal of improving and enriching women's lives by increasing awareness of heart health fits beautifully with Cal State LA's priorities. I like to say, and some of you here have heard this, I like to say that we are LA's university, LA's public university, for the public good. And this means essentially that caring and compassion for one another are the ethics that drive us. Our students, as part of their curriculum, serve in communities that surround us and learn firsthand to apply their academic training for the good of others. In other words, the health of the university community and the broader community is of vital importance to us. In this connection, we are very alert to the fact that most of our students are the first in their families to pursue a university degree. So they find themselves in a rewarding yet very demanding atmosphere, one that neither they nor their family members have ever experienced before. And this can be disorienting. And our students, along with students across the nation, are juggling academic requirements, jobs, family responsibilities, and other life issues. This is a package that activates stress, anxiety, sleeplessness, difficulty studying, staying focused. It is very challenging to go to college in the context of a busy and demanding life. And this often corresponds with less attention to nutrition, exercise, and other healthy choices that impact cardiovascular health. With this in mind, our First Lady, Dr. Debbie Covino, has made the inner well-being of students her signature priority. Debbie's there. There's Debbie right there. And so we call this initiative Mind Matters, right? At Cal State LA, we recognize that a student's inner well-being impacts every area of their lives: academic success, personal success, success in interpersonal relationships. So our goal is to integrate inner well-being into the framework of the university as a means of supporting student success. So to reach this goal, we've taken a number of steps: doubled the number of counselors at our student health center, provided more space, expanded given their efforts, we haven't expanded, they have expanded our student peer counselors, our student health advisory committee, to approaching 60 students. These are student volunteers who help carry the message of health and wellness to other students throughout the university community. We've adopted our first therapy dog named Remy, who will be on campus on various occasions to provide some welcome moments of companionship for students who are shuttling throughout the day. And we're offering the university community a wide range of practical tips and strategies for feeling better. Today, we have a table set up on the main walkway, and we hope that you'll stop by. There's a lot of wonderful activity on the walkway today connected with this event. There's a clear connection between the psychological and the physical, between mind and body, and that makes Mind Matters and Cal State LA an ideal partner for the work of the Women's Heart Alliance and the Clinton Foundation. As part of our commitment to improving student health, I am proud to announce that at tomorrow's meeting of our Faculty Senate and in meetings with our student governance, I will begin the process of making Cal State LA a smoke-free campus. I believe that we can create an even healthier university environment by removing the specter of first and secondhand smoke. We know that smoking cessation can reduce the risk of cardiovascular disease, and it is our responsibility to take steps in that direction. Through this effort, through the Mind Matters Initiative, through our new and welcome partnership with the Women's Heart Alliance and the Clinton Foundation, we will make this university a model of developing vibrant and healthy hearts and minds. And with that, I want to introduce one of the senior officers of the Women's Heart Alliance. We're very glad to have him here with us today, Art Ochoa.
Thank you very much, President Covino. It's my pleasure to be with you here today, and it's especially wonderful for me because Cal State LA is my dad's alma mater, and not unlike many of the students here at Cal State LA, he was working full-time and a parent when he was here as a student at Cal State LA, and I still remember going to his commencement as a small kid. So it's delightful to be back on the Cal State LA campus. As a member of the senior executive management team at Cedars-Sinai Health System, I want to pay a special tribute to the School of Nursing here at Cal State LA. Cedars-Sinai and the Cal State LA School of Nursing have a partnership that goes back more than 25 years, and it's been an enormously successful and productive partnership. As we all know, as you all know, your nursing program is an excellent one, and I'm grateful to say that many of our nurses at Cedars-Sinai are graduates of your program. Students here get a hands-on clinical experience at Cedars-Sinai, including a new elective course in operating room skills, which speeds the placement of RNs in ORs across Cedars-Sinai Health System and beyond. It's a powerful way to match Cal State LA talent with the growing need for OR-trained nurses in our state. I'm also honored to be here as a board member of the Women's Heart Alliance. I want to recognize the co-founders of our organization, the actress, singer, director, and philanthropist Barbara Streisand, who can't be with us today, and the chairman and chief executive officer of McAndrews and Forbes Incorporated, Ronald O. Perlman. The Alliance launched last fall with one all-important goal: to combat women's heart disease, the number one cause of death for women in our country, a disease more lethal than all cancers combined. Our rallying cry is Fight the Lady Killer. Earlier this year, in partnership with Clinton Health Matters Initiative, we began fighting for college-going women like you, many of you in the room, not all of you, because the best way to conquer heart disease is to prevent it from ever starting. We're truly excited about the role you can play in helping that effort. So to tell you more, I'm going to turn the mic over to the CEO of the Women's Heart Alliance, a leader in public health, British Robinson.
Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you, Art. And a special acknowledgement to a very dear friend of ours at the Women's Heart Alliance and to Cal State, Erica Glazer. Erica is a special friend to the Women's Heart Alliance and a great believer that all people should receive the health care and education they deserve. Erica, thank you for your support and thank you for being here. To Cal State LA students, staff, faculty, thank you all for being here. President Covino, Debbie Covino, it's been a pleasure to work with you and your entire team. You are simply extraordinary. Thank you for your leadership. As Art said, we could not be more excited about this partnership with Clinton Health Matters Initiative and the Clinton Foundation and launching it here today at Cal State LA. It's important for us to reach young women and men like you, the leaders of tomorrow. The Women's Heart Alliance was created to raise awareness, encourage action, and drive new research to fight heart disease. And today, it's all about our second goal, to encourage action. We want you to take control of your heart health and to help others around you do the same. Because the fact is, heart disease and stroke claim a woman's life every 90 seconds. nearly every 90 seconds. And while older women have seen a rapid decline in death rates from coronary heart disease, over the past 20 years, we've seen risk factors for cardiovascular disease, such as obesity, diabetes, and high blood pressure, rising among young women, and we are concerned. Certain pregnancy-related and sex-specific conditions double the risk of cardiovascular disease, including preeclampsia, eclampsia, gestational diabetes, stress, as the president just told us about, violence, and even trauma. And Black and Latino women, like many of us here today, are especially vulnerable. Why? Because persistent gaps in awareness, prevention, treatment, and support, gaps that we've got to work together to close once and for all. For example, half of Black women and roughly a third of Latino women have cardiovascular disease. Yet, only two-thirds are aware it's the leading cause of death. For too long, we've been conditioned to see heart disease as an old man's problem. Today, let's pledge to make heart health a young woman's priority. Go to our website, to fighttheladykiller.org, and take the pledge. Pledge to get heart checked. Students, you can go down to the Student Union Plaza today, right after this panel. Bring your friends, text them right now. We want to see you all there. And after today, tell five friends or loved ones to get heart checked. And we want you to write your members of Congress to advocate for funding for women's heart research. This is critical, because we don't know enough about women's hearts. Because even though heart disease can be deadly, it's also largely preventable. I want all of you, all young women everywhere, to be empowered to fight back. And we need the men here to join them as well. Today is really important to arm yourself with information. Just like you're educating yourselves for your careers, make sure to educate yourself about your heart health. Because the hard truth is, without your health, your career prospects are limited. You owe it to yourselves to look after yourselves. That's how you can be the best that you can be. I've been told that Cal State LA is the number one university of origin for Latino science and engineering PhD recipients. Wow, that's pretty amazing. That's a real tribute to the kind of talent and potential you all possess. And I don't want to see any of that potential get derailed because of a chronic health condition that could have been prevented. You are too important. You matter too much. So I want you to fight for your future. I want you to fight for each other and for all the amazing women in your lives. So get yourself heart checked, understand your risks, and learn how to prevent them. Let today be the day you take your heart into your own hands. Take the initiative to educate your friends, your family, and your neighbors. Use social media to spread the word in your community. You've got to use your smarts to look after your hearts. Working together, we can stop this terrible disease before it even starts. And if we do that, if you do that, there's no stopping how far you can go. Thank you, and we look forward to an excellent panel. And now I have the tremendous honor of introducing the panel, and President Covino will be joining us as well. But first, let me start with those introductions. First, our moderator, Dr. Rita Redberg, a leading cardiologist who grew up in Brooklyn and was the first in her family to attend college. She is a professor of medicine and director of women's cardiovascular services at the University of California, San Francisco, editor of JAMA Internal Medicine, and the author of many books about women's heart and women's health. Let me also say for anyone here who's considering a future in medicine, Dr. Redberg is an incredible role model, not just as an expert in her field, but as a champion for women's equality and of making sure that research and clinical trials take women into account, and those trials count you. Dr. Redberg also started a national committee at the American Heart Association called Women in Cardiology more than 20 years ago to promote the entry of and leadership of women in cardiology. Dr. Redberg, welcome and thank you. We are also honored and thrilled to welcome America's doctor, our Surgeon General, Dr. Vivek Murthy. As the son of immigrants, the grandson of a farmer in rural India, Dr. Murthy has devoted his life to improving public health through the lens of service, clinical care, research, education, and entrepreneurship. Since taking office, he brought incredible energy and vision to the work of Surgeon General. His goal is to build a culture of prevention in this country so that we can become as good at preventing illness as we are at treating it. Mr. Surgeon General, thank you for your leadership and for your service. Last but not least, a new friend, colleague, and partner, Janet Mejia. Janet is the president and CEO of the National Council of La Raza, the nation's largest Hispanic civil rights and advocacy organization in the United States. Previously, Janet worked in Washington, D.C., in the U.S. Congress, and at the White House. She worked for President Clinton and served as executive vice chancellor for university relations at her own alma mater, the University of Kansas. Janet also sits on the board for the Partnership for a Healthier America. She has made it her mission to improve health, awareness, access, and quality of care for Latinos. Thank you, Janet, and welcome. Dr. Covino, no introductions for you. You're the president. I'm going to call you back on stage. We're looking for a very exciting panel here, but before that, we're going to take a small little commercial break. President Covino, thank you all.
This weekend, all weekend, we involved our students in a code-a-thon, right? And we weren't hacking. We were creating a new app that will be used in the service of improving women's heart health by providing, you know, an engaging way of getting information, of learning more, and of staying connected and of spreading the word. So we had six teams of Cal State LA students compete over the weekend. They presented yesterday to our panel of judges that included Debbie and me and Josh Brenner, who you all have seen on Silicon Valley, and our provost, Lynn Mahoney. And so we had a very difficult task, but we did come to a winner among our students, all of whom will travel to the meeting of the Clinton Foundation in Palm Springs in January, and who will develop this app and move it forward and make a real contribution to the transformation of women's heart health. And they are here with us today, and the team name is Heart Plus. All right, where are you? Come on up.
Thank you, British. I'm so thrilled to be here for this exciting event and with all these incredible and energetic young people. It's really encouraging to see everyone here on behalf of women's heart health. And I'm really looking forward to a great conversation with our distinguished panel. I am a cardiologist, and I know not all of you here are, so I just wanted to clarify what we're talking about. So when we use terms, thank you.
Okay, now we'll get to the good part. So generally, the terms that we will use, heart disease, just generally, any kind of issue related to your heart, what we call sort of the bread and butter of heart disease is coronary artery disease, which is the kind when you get a blockage in your heart. And when we say it's the leading cause of death, usually we're talking about coronary artery disease. And then in the bigger picture, we have cardiovascular disease, which includes the heart and the brain. So issues like stroke, which we also call sometimes a brain attack to distinguish it from a heart attack. So we'll start with the Surgeon General and Dr. Murthy. Tell us how today's events connect to your important work as Air America's top doctor.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Redberg. And thank you so much, all of you, for being here and for inviting me here for this very special day. I must say that just looking out at everybody and hearing from President Canvino about the history of this university and about the demographics of the audience, I understand that many of you are first-generation college students, which is really extraordinary. I also understand that many of you are either immigrants or the children of immigrants or the grandchildren of immigrants. And that resonates with me very much because I am both an immigrant and the son of immigrants myself. My parents grew up in India. They came to this country back in the late 1970s. And when they came here, they were looking for very much what so many immigrants were looking for, which was a better opportunity in education for their kids. And my sister and I grew up with my parents in Miami, Florida. My mom and dad set up a medical practice there when I was very young. And it was for all intents and purposes, it was our life for the four of us. It's where I spent my evenings and my weekends. My sister and I would open the mail and read letters from insurance companies and clean up here and there whenever we could to help out. And that's where I got my inspiration to actually go into medicine. And it was a dream that was not only wonderful for me, but was incredible for my family, because just two generations prior to that, when my grandfather was growing coconuts and mango and tamarind and rice in the village in India, he never would have dreamed that his grandchildren would have the opportunity to study in the United States. I know many of you are living that dream right now, and your families are too, and I just want to tell you how happy I am for you and how much I support you in those journeys. It was in those early years, though, that I found my inspiration to go into medicine. But when I got to medicine, I realized a couple of things which I didn't expect. The first thing is I realized that many of the illnesses I was seeing in the hospital were actually preventable, and chief among those was heart disease. I also realized that not everyone presented the same way. What I mean by that is that not everyone felt the same way when they were having actual symptoms of heart disease. Some people had the classic chest pain that you see in the movies, where someone clutches their chest and they think something is wrong with their heart. But not everyone had those symptoms. And in particular, I found that women tended to have a different set of symptoms than men did. And that was something that I had to learn over the course of my training. But the second big thing that I learned when I got to medicine was that some conditions affect some groups much more than others. I saw, for example, that minority communities, Hispanic communities, African American communities, Asian American communities, were hit far harder by some illnesses like diabetes and heart disease than others. And that's why when I became Surgeon General, I made it my priority to focus both on prevention, on creating a country that's as good at preventing illness as we are at treating it, as well as focusing on health equities, or put another way, ensuring that everybody, regardless of what ethnic group they come from, regardless of whether they're a man or a woman, has a good shot and a fair shot at good health. So that's where my priorities are. And cardiovascular disease fits right in this square in the center of that. And that's why I'm so thrilled at the incredible work that the Women's Heart Alliance is doing. I'm grateful to Barbara and to British for your leadership. And that's why I'm also very excited about what President Covino just announced about the initiative to take the campus here to be smoke-free. That's incredibly important. You know, right now in the United States, a third of campuses are smoke-free and a quarter are entirely tobacco-free. And I would love it if we could get to a point where 100% of campuses in the United States were tobacco-free. That would be a big step forward to creating a healthier community, particularly when it comes to heart health. I know we're gonna have some time for Q&A, so I'll leave you with one last thought, which is, the question of what does it mean to build a culture of prevention? This is something I talk about everywhere I go, because I believe that When it comes to health, health isn't just something that happens in your doctor's office or in a hospital. Health is really about culture, right? It's about the food that we eat, about the activity that we do, about the forces and the relationships in our lives which help determine whether we are emotionally well or not. And those three components, physical activity, nutrition, emotional well-being, these are the cornerstones of a culture of prevention. This is what we have to build and support in our individual lives and in our institutions if we want to become a healthier country. Whenever I go out, I usually ask people, would you prefer to get diabetes and then be treated for it, or to prevent diabetes in the first place? That's really a no-brainer. Most people say I'd rather prevent it in the first place. But if you look at how we invest our time and our resources as a country, we invest the lion's share of our time and money in treatment. And treatment is really important. It's because we've invested so much in that that we have some of the best treatments in the world. But imagine what could happen if we invested just as much in prevention, if we prevented heart disease before it started. That's really the goal of today. That's really the goal of my tenure as Surgeon General. That's why I'm excited that we're here to talk about how to create a healthier community and a healthier country.
Thank you so much, Dr. Murphy. Really, really inspiring, and I'll just share also that my parents didn't graduate from high school, and I think being here at this great university and taking advantage of extra educational opportunities like you are by being here is just such a great path for all of you. I'm very excited and proud. Janet, we know that Latino women face a higher risk of heart disease. We also know that we need a lot more research into women, and in particular into Latina women, and we're really working hard as part of Women's Heart Alliance on getting more women and more minority women in clinical trials. What are some of the National Council of La Raza's priorities for improving women's lives?
Sure, thank you, and I also want to add my gratitude for being part of this wonderful event and part of the partnership here. I was thrilled to be asked to be here as president and CEO of the National Council La Raza. We're the largest Latino civil rights and advocacy organization in the country. But I too was drawn by the diversity that I see here and inspired by your engagement, not only in furthering your education, but being here. And my story is similar, I guess, a little bit with a few twists. My parents came to this country from Mexico and settled in Kansas, of all places. There are Latinos and Latinas and in Kansas, but they came with very little money, but big dreams and hopes for their children. And I think my mom had a fifth grade education, my dad a seventh grade education. And they helped, you know, raise and create a home for me and my six brothers and sisters. And while they didn't have an education themselves, they certainly wanted to make sure that we did everything we could to better ourselves and promoted that as a value for us. And you know, they saw my brother Ramon become enrolled in, and graduate from Harvard Law School. And he's a wonderful attorney, but giving back to the community today, heading up the largest community Hispanic scholarship development fund in the country and sits on the Kellogg Board of Directors. My brother Carlos graduated from law school and serves as the first Latino judge in the federal district court in Kansas. My twin sister Mary serves as the first Latina to serve as a federal district court judge and was recently promoted and elevated to the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals. And I'm so proud that my parents were able to see me work in the West Wing of the White House for President Clinton and graduate from law school and see my career there. It is that story of the American dream. And while we didn't pursue careers in health, we pursued, many in my family pursued careers in law. To me, what spoke to me was the importance of advocacy and advocating on behalf of our families, on behalf of our communities, and on behalf of those who are more vulnerable and don't have a voice. And that's what I see here today, really, is an opportunity for each of us to be advocates for our families, but for ourselves. And as Latinas, many who are victims, women of color, victims of the lady killer disease that we're here talking about, I think a lot of people don't recognize that it is the largest killer of women, and we have to talk in those blunt terms. But very few people realize that, and very few women of color realize that, Latinas in particular. And it's important for you to recognize that you're not in this alone. There are institutions that are helping to promote your wellness on behalf of you all. And there are organizations like the National Council on Raza that, while we're known for civil rights advocacy and immigration work, we also have a strong record of impact in promoting health programs and health advocacy. And the programs that we've supported over the years include heart health programs, so that our communities can be better informed about what those risks are. We support Promotoras de Salud, a program of lay health educators that are really seen as trusted voices in the community that are helping our mothers and grandmothers and different folks who are in these households cooking and doing different things for the families to make sure that not only are they taking care of their families, but they're taking care of themselves. And as a result, we've seen more women through these programs become engaged and full participants in their own well-being. We have Sana La Rana, which is a cholesterol heart health promotion. You all know the phrase from a cultural expression growing up in our community. And part of what makes some of these programs successful is the cultural competencies that you need when you're engaging communities. Because it's not just about speaking to folks in Spanish or any other language anymore. You have to know how to connect into these communities, because as the Surgeon General will tell you, the best evaluation for whether a program is working or not is not so much whether you've read something about it, it's whether you've done something about it. How can we change behaviors? Well, if you're not engaging folks in the way they want to hear information, the way they are accessing information that encourages them to change behavior, then you're not really making a difference. And that's why I'm here promoting also community-based organizations, local organizations that many of you probably have in your communities. If you're not already engaging them, they can be great sources of information and programs that can help you inform yourself, empower yourself, and be those agents of change for you and your community. We have other programs that we want to be able to talk about in addition to that, but one of the most important things that I feel like our organization has done in the most recent last year or two, last 4 or 5 years, is promoting enrollment in the Affordable Care Act. Because not enough of our communities are covered with insurance. We're the most uninsured community. And it's important for us to understand that if we have the opportunity and are eligible to be covered, that is the watchword for prevention. When you're covered, you're having access to more prevention-oriented services. And so we have partnered with community-based organizations and other organizations to make sure that more and more of our community are getting signed up for that coverage, because that's where prevention will be ultimately the key in avoiding these diseases.
That was great. Thank you, Janet. Another key to promoting health and wellness is to make sure that our medical professionals and researchers are responsive to, as well as representative of, the community that they represent. President Covino, I know Cal State LA is a leader in the Minorities Opportunity in Research Programs, or MORE. Can you tell us more about MORE?
Yes, MORE. I have to use the Elvis mic.
That's right. Okay.
There it is. Okay. MORE, Minority Opportunities in Research, is a program that is one of our points of pride here at Cal State LA. It's funded by the National Science Foundation, by the National Institutes of Health, and it is to prepare motivated students, successful students, to move forward from bachelor's and master's degrees to doctoral degrees in the sciences and technology, and to really do transformative work with those degrees. And British mentioned earlier, and I just want to emphasize once again, that the National Science Foundation has verified that Cal State LA is the top baccalaureate institution of origin for Latino science and engineering PhD recipients in the country. No university anywhere produces the new Latino PhDs in science and technology at the rate that we do. Over, as of this last year, it's about 120 PhDs in completing programs all over the country, doing very distinguished work. And what's most notable for our purposes here today about our Moore students is that most of them are pursuing biomedical, biomedicine, bioengineering, biochemical research. They are the people who are going to make the transformative discoveries that impact diagnosis and affect the lives of folks who may right now be plagued by very difficult conditions, but because of the work of our Cal State LA generated scientists are going to find relief and greater well-being in the future. So we're very, very proud of the Moore program, especially because it represents the dedication of the larger community to move forward and make a difference and then give back through the kinds of research that they're doing.
Great, thank you, President Covino.
I just wanted to mention that I didn't quite get to the one final point that you had asked about, and that is the underrepresentation of not just minorities, but women and women of color as some of these studies and trials are being done. I know, General Murthy, you may be able to add to this, but part of the advocacy work that the National Council of Laudasa does at the national level is trying to make sure that whether it's for making sure that the makeup of those profiles that are being conducted for those clinical trials are more reflective of really our population today, and seeing those diverse communities represented in those trials is really important, because how we test some of these different drugs or treatments isn't the same on everybody, even as you look at men and women, but even of people of color. And then looking at the appropriations that are set aside for some of these different research studies is really important. And we need to elevate our voices in advocating for those changes, because that is also important. That has an important impact on us at the end of the day, but when they're having those discussions, oftentimes in what is considered to be out of touch of, Washington, D.C. congressional efforts, we have to make sure we're breaking through, and we can do more of that as we advocate ourselves, community by community, and make sure that that message is heard back in Washington, where a lot of times some of those decisions are made.
Such important work. Thank you.
Do you want to comment on that, General?
Sure. Happy to.
Yeah, let's
always
hear
happy
from
to talk.
Yeah.
Well, I very much also believe that our healthcare workforce and our research community has to reflect the larger community that it's meant to serve. If it doesn't, then we run into problems where the trials we run, the treatments we deliver, even with the best of intentions, may not reach the communities they're meant to reach. And I'll actually give you a very simple example of something that just happened 2 weeks ago. 2 weeks ago, I was at home over the weekend with my wife, Alice, and we received a text message from a friend who said, "My friend is having a medical emergency in his family. Can he call you?" And so we got on the phone, and it turned out that his mother had been throwing up over the last few days, and when she was vomiting, she noticed that there was actually blood that was coming out. And she was really concerned, and she started to feel lightheaded and dizzy, so she went to the doctor. And when she went to the doctor, they measured something called her hemoglobin level. And that's a measure of how much blood essentially is in your system. You can think of it that way. And they found that her hemoglobin level was about 10. And that's lower than it should be for a woman. Usually if you're a woman somewhere around 13, 14, it would be like a normal hemoglobin level. But it had dropped to 10. And they said, "Well, you should really see a stomach doctor because you could be bleeding from your stomach." They set up an appointment for her in 2 days. But 24 hours later, her symptoms got worse. She started to get more dizzy. She got more lightheaded. She was vomiting even more. She went to the hospital and to the emergency room. They checked her hemoglobin again, and it had dropped to 7. So what this means is she had lost essentially half of her entire blood supply over the preceding few days. Now, what they realized in the hospital is that she needed a blood transfusion as soon as possible, but she refused the blood transfusion. And you might ask, well, with her life on the line, why would she say no? And her heart rate was going up, which was a bad sign. Her blood pressure was dropping, which was a really bad sign. They checked her hemoglobin again. A few hours later, found it had dropped to 5. So now she'd lost 2/3 of her blood supply. But the reason she said no is that she was African American, and she felt that nobody around her was from her community or understood her perspective, and she didn't trust the folks who were in the hospital who were providing care to her. And we can talk about the many reasons why that is. There have been a lot of historic, difficult experiences that many minority communities, particularly the African American community, has had with the healthcare system. But what it took is it took somebody she knew and trusted, somebody who understood her cultural background and experience, to actually go and talk to her. And unfortunately, that person didn't exist at that hospital at that time, on the weekend of that particular day. So we spoke to her son, and we said, what you need to do is you need to get on a plane right now, and you need to make a beeline for the hospital and talk to her, because with a blood level that much, at low, at 5, she may not even survive until the next day. So that's what he did. And he was able to convince her to get a blood transfusion, convince her that the people in the hospital weren't trying to hurt her or just, you know, get her into surgery so they could make more money. But this was actually such a clear example to me of how how people don't necessarily trust the system when they don't feel that their experiences and their community is reflected in it. That's why diversity in the workforce is so important. It's why researchers also have to be diverse so that they understand the larger community and its needs. And that's why it's important not just for us to say that, but it's important for universities to do what this university is doing, which is to encourage students from minority communities to go into science, to go into research, to go into practicing medicine, because that ultimately is going to change what we study and how we deliver care.
Dr. Murphy, that was amazing story. I wanted to talk a little bit about how we do change sort of mindsets and behaviors. We know it's not easy, but we know it can be done. Certainly in our lifetimes, I can remember cars that didn't have seat belts and people riding without bicycle helmets, and now we pretty much take all of that for granted. Just an example right here, you announced we have smoke-free campuses now, something we didn't have 10 years ago. So things can change. You've just unveiled a new initiative, Step It Up, to promote walking and walkable communities. And I have to say, I was so excited when I read about that, because no patient leaves my office without hearing about the benefits of walking. And I really believe if walking, you know, was a pill, it would be a blockbuster, because it is so good for you. You know, it doesn't really have any side effects. It makes you feel better mentally, physically. You know, you live longer. You walk with friends, you have all kinds of social opportunities. Anyway, you'll tell us more. So you can now tell us, what is your plan to get America walking?
Sure. Well, thank you so much for mentioning that. A lot of times when I go around, I ask people, what do you think the Surgeon General does? And everyone has varied ideas on what this is, and it's really fascinating for me to hear. Some people think I spend my entire day stamping cigarette boxes and alcohol bottles with warnings. Other people think that I primarily go around and give talks. Some people think I issue reports. And the truth is, there's a lot of all of that in the job. But the job has traditionally been that of a communicator, to go out and communicate the best available science on public health. There are two things I really want to do while I'm in office in terms of approach. One is to modernize how we communicate. That's to ensure that we are not just putting out reports, but that we're using new technology, new tools, new messages, and new messengers to actually go out and bring people important information about health. It's why we teamed up with Elmo earlier this year to work on getting the message out about vaccinations during the measles outbreak. And it's why we'll be teaming up with more interesting folks down the line. But the other thing that is really important is to go beyond conveying information, just working directly with communities to translate that information into real change. You know, in 2015, people have access to a lot of information. Sometimes it's the right information, sometimes it's the wrong information, but there's a lot of information out there. But all of us know that just because you have the right information doesn't mean that you incorporate it into your life in a way that actually improves your health. So that's been the second area of focus, is to work directly with communities to do that. The call to action that we put out recently on walking and walkable communities was an effort to really combine both of those. And what it was is an effort to take something that's really simple, walking, something we've done for millennia, and help people see that this turns out to be one of the most powerful tools that we have to roll back the tide of diabetes, of heart disease, and other chronic illnesses which are threatening our country. And these illnesses, chronic illnesses, are really a threat now. 7 out of 10 deaths in America are from chronic illnesses. It costs us over $1 trillion a year in healthcare costs. Imagine what could happen if we prevented it. And we know that if you walk on average just 22 minutes a day, and you do that at a brisk pace, that you can actually reduce your chances of developing heart disease and diabetes. That's just with 22 minutes a day. You don't need expensive equipment, expensive memberships. Walking, it turns out, can be really powerful. It's one of the pillars I mentioned that we need to build a culture of prevention: physical activity, good nutrition, and emotional well-being. And so that's why we put out this call to action. But we did it not just by putting, a press release out there and issuing a report, but by building partnerships with community organizations, including some that you would expect, like healthcare organizations and nonprofits like the YMCA, but some that you may not think about, like the International Council on Shopping Centers. What does a shopping center have to do with walking? Well, it turns out when it's really cold or really hot, shopping centers are a great place to walk. And there's a growing culture of mall walkers in America. Now, obviously you may have to leave your pocketbook in the car when you do this if you want to keep your bank account in the black. But malls are a great place to actually walk. And so the ICSC is helping to develop more mall walker programs. So this is how we need to bring every segment of society together to build that culture of prevention. You might think, I'm just a student, what can I really do to improve health? Or I'm going to be a lawyer or an engineer, or a cook, well, what can I really do to improve health? Well, it turns out all of us have a big role to play, because you can make every decision you make in your day-to-day life can be a step toward better health. The decision about whether to walk home versus drive home, whether to take the stairs or the elevator, the decision about what you eat for lunch or dinner on a particular day, the decision about whether you engage in activities that help you be emotionally well. But even going beyond yourself, all of us have people we love in our lives who we want to be healthier. And that's why, while we're here talking about women's heart disease, the responsibility for reducing heart disease among women is not just the responsibility of women, but it's a responsibility of men as well. And that's why we have to come together to tell the people that we love information that they need, but also to help them live a lifestyle that's healthier. I'll tell you, actually, my mother is someone who's on my mind today, because I spoke to her just before I came over here. And my mom is someone we've been trying to get walking for years. My father gets up at 5 a.m. He walks 3 miles every day before he even goes to the office. But we can't get my mom to do the same. And we've tried walking with her, but I can't be in Miami all the time. It's been hard. So finally, before we released the call to action on walking, I called my mother and I said, "Mom, okay, I'm about to release this national call to action on walking where I'm asking every American to walk. And it's going to look really bad if the Surgeon General's mother is not walking." So she said, "Okay." And in fact, when I talked to her this morning, she told me her latest tally of steps. She's been tracking her steps on her iPhone. And she broke 10,000 yesterday, and she was really, really excited. But just to say that we have to tell the people we love as well about the importance of walking, because these are really the three levels of engagement that we need. We need change in our personal lives. We need to help change the lives of the people that we love. And we have to help change the culture and environment in our institutions and our community. That involves shifting what we're doing at your university, the way President Covino talked about with the tobacco-free policies. It also involves advocacy, in helping our leaders understand what we need in terms of health and how they can better support it.
That's great, and I think you've all now given everyone in the audience very detailed tips on how we can do that on a personal level as well as on a community and a larger level.
Can I build on just the other piece on the nutrition side? And I have a mom story too, so it might build. But it actually reflects one of the programs that NCLR has promoted with our affiliates, these community-based organizations, Comprando Rico y Saludable. What that means is buying, very delicious but healthy foods. And what we've done is try to work with these lay health promoters, promotoras, but working with, a lot of times it is the women who are responsible for cooking, but trying to get them to change some of their habits. And I remember this because it was quite an important conversation that when we were going through school, trying to explain to my mom and how important it was, because a lot of us, particularly in different communities, are used to certain ingredients because that's how our food tastes. And if you have, you know, certain dishes that are either Latino or other dishes, you really want to make sure that they have that flavor. But a lot of women need to be convinced. And I remember my mom cooking with lard all the time before anybody talked about, you know, manteca and lard. And but because it was so flavorful in terms of the way the, you know, so we had to work really hard with her. I remember as the kids in the family to convince her to move from, you know, lard to oil, at least to kind of try to make it a healthier. But, you know, some folks are resistant. And while we did get her to change her behavior, mostly, the tortillas, she couldn't give up the lard in the tortillas, but she changed it oil for almost everything else. But when you can have programs that take folks through the, on the nutrition side, healthier eating habits, and you combine that with the exercise, you start to make you know, inroads in terms of how folks can change their lifestyles. And at the end of the day, you're trying to get folks to change, period, something about their life, whether it's doing more exercise or changing their eating habits. And I think there are ways that, you know, programs can be effective in helping educate even the most stubborn women who want to hang on to their recipes the way they used to understand what the trade-off is. And if they understand that their children and their spouses are going to be healthier and their families are going to be healthier, then they'll make that trade-off. And it takes a little bit of time, but it's really important. And oftentimes, we're, again, as young people, we're the best messengers in our own homes for how we need to do that. A lot of times we're the translators in our homes when folks need to go to the doctor and other things. So we need to just make sure we're doing our part to help and bring those healthier lifestyle changes to our families.
I need to one-up you on the mom stories.
Oh, okay.
My mom is here today.
Oh, so my goodness.
Present, right?
Oh, my.
So we're, and my sister Joanne, who is a longtime nurse and has sort of kept the family on the straight and narrow. Mm-hmm. So we're making a family commitment here today to the cause. And just one note relative to what the Surgeon General mentioned about supporting others in our families in their efforts. At the same time that we are inviting our women students to have their hearts checked today, we also have, and Debbie composed this, a pledge for the men to support their women. And so there are pledges down there for you men. You can sign them, and then we're going to put you in a database so that we can track your support. I haven't signed mine yet, but I promise. I promise that I will. But it is offering that kind of support together and working together as a family is just crucial, I think.
Thank you. All right, I'll share a very short mom story. In my culture, it was getting rid of schmaltz or chicken fat and replacing that with olive oil. But I will say my mom, who is not here today, and I'd get in trouble if she heard me say this, but she's 90. And I think it's because she walks every day, and she actually walks to the gym and does yoga every day. And she happens to be yoga people a lot younger than her, which I think helps her too. But Janet, the National Council of La Raza met recently in San Antonio. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about how where people live and work and play affect our health, and how we can ensure that the built environment supports healthy lifestyles, particularly in Latino.
Yeah, I think what, you know, it reflected, that summit reflected a lot of the different aspects that you're hearing today about healthier lifestyles. But I think what we're trying to promote is, you know, a movement of health. I mean, and understanding that we need a culture of health and healthier living. And what that means is, yes, we have personal things that we can do. We can do things within our families. But what we're recognizing at the National Council of Raza, as we look at, you know, Latino communities, but as we look across America today, you know, we need to be invested in the overall well-being of our communities and a holistic approach. And, you know, that's why we're promoting, yes, healthy programs and advocacy for policy changes that are going to be important. But we feel like we have to promote the various positive changes for our communities that affect families overall, that affect individuals overall. So we promote stronger economic reforms because we feel like if people are able to have jobs, then they're going to be less stressed about what they need to do day to day. And we promote, obviously, the importance of safer communities. And we want to make sure that folks feel like they're in communities that are safe and there are not just green spaces, but that they can go and come and to and from work in their lifestyles. We need to take an approach that allows us to understand that in certain communities, like in Latino communities, where we have mixed status families, where we don't have immigration reform, there is a lot of stress on those families because they don't know if they can get to work or to back and forth every day. So we fight for immigration reform. And I guess the point is that we have to understand that as individuals and as families and as communities, we need to be engaged. We need to participate civically in what we're doing beyond just getting through our day at school or getting through that day in terms of your work. Because when we can affect the policies that affect all of us as communities, that can help us be healthier overall. It's the health with a capital H in terms of us having healthier environments. And that becomes really important too. So for us, yes, specific programs and policies are really important, but we should all be civically engaged in understanding that we can act and participate and yes, even make sure we're voting in every election, because the kind of leaders that are directing the different policies that we have at the local and state and national level, it does matter. And we ought to be able to say that we can control and determine our own destinies. And we can do that in a lot of different ways, but I think sometimes we need to be reminded that we need to pull every lever that we have, and whether that's inside our homes or in our communities, but certainly we can all make a difference, and we have to pay attention to what's going around so that the policies that are affecting our communities are changing. And that's why we had that summit most recently, because we wanted to remind people that there's an overarching theme here, and that is that we ought to be looking at all the issues that are affecting the well-being of our families.
Yeah, sure.
Those are great comments, and this made me think of a couple of thoughts I wanted to share. One is, I think what underpins those is this idea that environment drives health, and that's true everywhere in this country. But the other point I want to make, though, is that you have more control over the environment than you think you do. For example, those of you who are students might think, well, I don't really have any power to change the environment. What can I really do? Well, who makes a decision, for example, about what food gets served at student meetings? You know, at the meetings of a particular club or an association on campus, a lot of times it's you and your fellow students that have the power to make those decisions. When you think about what food choices are available to you on campus or in your work site, I know many of you are working jobs while you're also studying, which is incredibly admirable, and I want to just tell you how appreciative I am that you're able to do all of that work together. It's really admirable. But think about that. You have a whole other sphere where you can influence what is offered in terms of food and what is amenable in terms of physical activity. And this really makes a difference. You think about it, most people spend about a third of their time in school or work. And that means that the food that's available in the cafeteria at work has an impact on the choices you make. It means whether or not your workplace or your campus is walkable or not has a real impact on your likelihood of walking or not. And that's why it's so important that each of us use our voice when it comes to advocating for choices and opportunities to live a healthier life. It's why we should make sure that our kids in school and grade school had the opportunity to eat healthy foods and build a foundation for healthy living from day one. It's why we have to also make sure that they have time for activity. You know, when you look at this on the back end, you might think, well, you know, it seems like that would take a lot of time, or we have other priorities that we have to deal with. But I'll tell you that it is a lot cheaper to deal with these issues up front than it is to deal with them after we've developed chronic illness. And it's actually a failure to do the former, to address these things up front, that's led to the crisis that we have today. You know, there's a community in Florida, in West Wabasso, Florida, which decided, it's a community that's dealing with tough times. They've got 50% of the people some years ago who are below the federal poverty line. But they made a decision that they were going to invest in building their infrastructure to promote health. And they invested in lighting, in building sidewalks. And by the way, 3 out of 10 people in America live in neighborhoods that don't even have sidewalks. So walking isn't always as easy as we think. And they also invested in cleaning up some vacant lots and turning them into parks. What they found 2.5 years later is that 95% of the residents had increased their amount of physical activity outdoors. And when asked why, it was because there was more lighting and more walkable spaces. You see examples like that all over the country, where in New York City, for example, as Dr. Redberg may know, there's a Green Carts initiative there, which has enabled small, entrepreneurial operations to go from neighborhood to neighborhood and sell fresh fruits and vegetables. And what's been really interesting is not only has that enabled neighborhoods which typically don't have access to fresh fruits and vegetables to buy them, but it's actually changed what a lot of the other surrounding bodegas or offer as well, because they've realized that, hey, there's some more demand for fruits and vegetables, we should stock them too. So there are interesting spillover ripple effects that can happen when you, as one person, stand up and ask for change and make change in your lives, in the lives of the people around you, and in your institution. So I'd very much encourage you to do that, because it's in communities that health is ultimately determined, less so, believe it or not, in hospitals and in clinics.
Thank you. President Covino, it's clear that you have been very successful in building a culture here at the university that values health. And I'm wondering if you would share some of your wisdom and what you've learned, what advice you'd give for other university presidents on how to start building a culture of health in universities and colleges.
Well, I think it's important that we make a culture of health and the importance of it visible and emphatic over and over and over again. Anyone who hears me speak knows that it's always at the top of the list. But it also requires, and this is sort of beyond our control, but a great gift when we get it, and we have it here at Cal State LA, it also requires a responsive and caring community. And we have that here at so many places in so many ways. For instance, Walter Zelman. Walter, are you here today? There's Walter's back here. Professor Walter Zelman, who's the chair of public health here, led a project to increase enrollment in Covered California, which is our version of the Affordable Care Act, to reduce uninsured students in the California State University system. Right? The result, 260,000 students and family members are now insured because of what Walter and his students did in that effort. So, that's part of what I mean by being at a wonderful place with wonderfully dedicated people. And there's a little bit of crack in the whip, you know, that needs to happen. Our whole president's leadership team, which includes our vice presidents, our deans, our directors, and Debbie and I spent 2 days in August being certified in mental health first aid. We are certified, in case anyone needs mental health first aid today, we're certified. And it was important to announce to the campus that at the leadership level, we are so concerned and so invested in the health and well-being of our students in our community that we want ourselves to be liaisons. So I think sending that message is a very, very important step.
Dr. Murthy, you've spoken eloquently about what you call the great American community. How can everyone here and across the country get more involved in improving the health and well-being of our country?
Well, thank you. That's a great question. And it's a timely question, because when we look at history and where our country has been, when we look at the challenges that we have faced in health, we have this incredible opportunity now, what I think of as an inflection point in history, where we can reverse potentially the difficult and negative trends we've had in health and shift our country to a healthier place. But that will only, the reason I believe that we're at that potential inflection point is because we've already seen some changes happening. We've seen an incredible expansion in coverage through the Affordable Care Act, where we have millions and millions more people who are covered who didn't have that opportunity before. We have also, in part related to the law, but related to other things as well, we have healthcare systems that are starting to rethink how they deliver care, thinking about, for example, how to engage more effectively with the community, how to build prevention into their work. And that's a big shift. That's an important change. But the real big shift that we have to make, beyond coverage, beyond changing how we deliver care, is thinking about how we build this culture of prevention in America. The thing about this culture of prevention is it starts very locally. It starts at home. And that's why each of us do have a powerful role that we can play. You know, it starts with decisions we make in our day-to-day lives. And don't think that your decisions aren't powerful, because the choices you make at a restaurant, at the grocery store, they collectively have a very big impact on what food companies choose to offer. If you look at what's offered right now in our grocery stores, it's quite different than what was offered when I was a child, when I was growing up. And that's because people collectively demanded something different. The shifts that we've had, you know, over time haven't always been the right shifts. You know, we swing one way or another depending on whether the latest thing is to eliminate fats or eliminate carbohydrates, eliminate this or that or the other. But what it does show you is that when people come together and have basically shift their demand, they can actually change what food producers actually supply. So this is why it's so important for us to not underestimate the choices we make in our individual lives. So what I would ask of all of you is to, one, to think about the choices you make in your life. What can you do today that will help you lead a healthier life? What can you do to make better choices around nutrition, better choices around physical activity, incorporating that in your life whenever possible? The second thing I would ask you to do is to think about who you can talk to. If we have, you know, 100, 200 people in this room who talk to five people, that starts to become a really big impact. You know, that also word of mouth is an incredible way for messages to spread. It's not also just important because of the numbers. It's because if you think about who has the ability to change what your mom thinks, it's great likely that you have a greater ability to do that than, let's say, a local leader or an elected leader or somebody that your mom doesn't know. And the great example that you gave of how you changed the way your mom cooked, I think, is a powerful example of that. So talking to the people you love is very important. And the last piece is to look at the other spheres that you have influence in. If you are somebody who works at a company, you know, and you have influence over what's offered there in terms of food, if you plan to begin your own business someday, you know, where you'll have a chance to influence the kind of environment that's created for your employees, if you're somebody who votes, which I hope is everybody in this room, presuming, of course, that you're a voting age, don't vote if you're not a voting age. Not a good idea. It's called fraud. But anyhow, if you're a voting age, you know, your vote also is powerful, and it's a tool that you have that you can use to speak up for the priorities that matter for you. So we all have to engage on these levels. The people sometimes ask me when I travel, they say, what do you think the biggest public health problem is that's facing America? And they're looking for me to say, is it diabetes? Is it cancer? What is it? What I often tell them is the greatest challenge that's facing the health of America right now is a sense of disempowerment that people have around their health. A sense that the problems we face when it comes to our health are too big for us to solve. A belief that our health is determined by forces that are beyond our control, whether it's hospitals or the government or the food industry or others. But the truth is we have more agency, we have more power than we sometimes let ourselves believe. And that power is on display each and every day in the choices that we make. So that's why we have to choose well, we have to choose wisely, and we have to help the people around us do the same.
That was a great way to finish our conversation. I think it's been a fantastic conversation. Thank you, Dr. Murthy, Janet, and President Covino. We would like to let the audience and students get some questions and discussion, and I think perhaps we have some questions from some of our students. Yes.
Okay. Hi, my name is Lauren Jorgensen. I am a public health major and a student in the Honors College here at Cal State LA. And my question for you, Dr. Murthy, is what is being done, or what do you think you feel could still be done about raising awareness about the signs, symptoms, and prevalence of women's heart disease, specifically in Latina and African American populations?
Thank you so much for that question. I think one of the most important things that we can do is to have local community leaders speaking up more about it. As I mentioned earlier, sometimes the most powerful voices are local voices. Sometimes the people that folks listen to the most are the ones that they know and they trust in their churches, in their temples, in their businesses, in their universities, in their families. So I think if we really want to ensure that everybody in the country understands how to prevent heart disease, how to recognize the symptoms of it, we can't just rely on a few national organizations to do that work. National organizations are really important. The Women's Heart Alliance is incredibly important, is going to be a great force for helping us do this. But ultimately, the responsibility lies on people in individual communities to get the word out, to talk to the people that you love. So building like local coalitions that can do that, helping build efforts on campuses, as you're doing right here at the university, are so important. Before I came here, I actually peeked over the balcony up on the second floor and saw the health hut that was out there in the pavilion. I saw the table that you have set up for Mind Matters. I heard that there was also a nutrition booth that people can go to. Those are really important. Like, don't underestimate how powerful those are, because you know, as much as big national stories may go around from time to time in the papers, in 2015, not everyone reads the paper. Not that many people watch TV as they used to back in the day and get their source from the local news. So where are they getting their information? Well, they're actually getting it from you, the people they know, either directly through their social media feeds or others. So that, I think, is really what we have to do, is get local community members and leaders to speak up more and more. That's how we're going to get the information out about how to prevent heart disease.
Question.
Good afternoon. My name is Brianna Chavez. I'm a mechanical engineering student here. People in lower income communities, which are often communities of color, tend to have less access to health care and poorer health than those in better off areas. I was wondering if you can tell me what's being done right now specifically to address these disparities.
Well, I think one of the most effective ways is here at the local community level is the work that many of the community-based organizations are doing. I know many folks here probably might be familiar with AltaMed, maybe with Eastmont Community Center. We've got Mexican American Opportunity Fund, MAOF. I mean, there's lots of different community-based organizations that are able to either provide some support and programs and services, not referrals to those that can't. And I think it's important, if you're not getting information here on campus, to look in your own communities, where there are more often than not, increasingly, not only community-based organizations, but ones that are geared up to help provide guidance around what those disparities are and how you can get help. And so I agree with the Surgeon General. I mean, nothing anymore today is not just using the internet, but there's opportunities and programs in your own communities that you can access to get that information. And I think once you do that, you can see the wealth of resources that are out there. But you know, it's really important, if you don't see that there, to be persistent and to make sure that you're creating that mini movement within your own community to create something that isn't there. Or if there are organizations there that aren't providing services or information, to be part of that effort to make it happen, because I do want to reinforce this important theme that change can happen, but it takes every individual being engaged and involved and participating. And it can be around a particular program, or it can be around a policy, something that you see that should change for some reason because you see it adversely affecting or not seeing that opportunity. There's a lot of national organizations, but not all of them are in every community. But we're proud that we have an affiliate network that actually works in a lot of the different communities to provide that information and that kind of support. And I hope you'll seek it out.
We are. That has been an amazing conversation. I think we've all gotten a lot of tips, things we've learned, and things we can go out and do, both for ourselves, for our families, and for the larger community. On behalf of the Women's Heart Alliance, I want to thank Cal State LA. I want to thank Dr. Murthy, Janet, and President Covino, and the Clinton Foundation for this amazing event and the whole weekend, really. It was great.
Thank you.
Great deal of work.